Welcome everybody to our first session, which is going to be Chris Cotter telling us about Panic of 1873. Chris, I think you have, 30 minutes, and then Discussant will have, about 10 minutes, and then we'll hopefully have 10 minutes for discussion. If you, anytime you have a question, I guess feel free to interrupt, and I'll try to monitor the chat to flag things if anybody puts something there. So with that, I turn the floor to Chris.
Okay, great. Thanks. Thank you, Mark. So yeah, let me share my screen. Okay, can everyone see that? Good. Okay, so yeah, thanks for having me. I'm very excited to be presenting this and to hear your feedback on this. Been working on this for quite a while, and some of you you know, may have seen this recently at the Rutgers workshop, but I look forward to hearing everyone's thoughts. So this paper is focused around the Panic of 1873. And specifically looking at the impacts of this bond default crisis that coincided with the panic. So this huge wave of railroad bond defaults, can we try and tease out some real economic effects of this wave of corporate defaults, specifically in the railroad industry? So the Panic of 1873, coincided with, you know, the largest corporate bond default crisis of the post-Civil War period, really, American history, and I'll put up some numbers to kind of illustrate that. It centered almost entirely around the railroad industry, over 100 railroad firms going into receivership, right? So these railroads, you know, default on their bonds, are sued by the bondholders, and the judge appoints a receiver to operate the railroad while all of this is hashed out. So the question of interest in this paper is, did this railroad bond default crisis have significant effects on the real economy? And can we tease out impact on the railroads themselves and on the areas where they operated? So just some context. There's a great paper by Gieske et al. Looking at, you know, over 150 years of corporate bond default crises. Finding that they typically don't have the same type of severe effects on the macroeconomy that you'd have with something like a banking panic. But I'll argue that for a couple of reasons, the 1873 crisis is unique, both because of just how big it is and because of the lack of legal mechanisms for properly resolving these debt defaults. And so we might have some reason to expect that this is going to have local economic impacts. So what am I actually doing in the paper? So I'm using locational data, GIS data, on the transportation network. I'm linking that with the railroad firms operating particular lines, right? And this is, you know, an era with hundreds of railroad firms operating, right, prior to, you know, waves of consolidations and large, you know, land grant systems of railroads, right? We still have hundreds of railroad firms. And so I'm going to link the railroad defaults to economic outcomes in the areas where those railroads operated, specifically measured by the balance sheets of local banks. So yeah. I'm gonna use what I call a third question. I'm gonna use what I call service areas to determine kind of the most economically relevant railroad lines to any particular bank or any particular area. And look at the incidence of default in those service areas and link that to bank level outcomes. So what I find is that banks that operate in areas where lots of railroads went into default saw declines in their loans and deposits and increases in excess reserves. So I show some evidence also that railroads cut back significantly on their operations when they went into default. And I also try a little bit to address this question of why so many of these railroads were in a precarious financial position in the first place. And I find that specifically land grant railroads are significantly more likely than others to default. So kind of suggesting a fundamental reason for some of these defaults. So a little bit of background. So the Panic of 1873 marks the beginning of the so-called Long Depression, with the boom and bust centered heavily around the railroad industry, right? So associated industries and machinery production see significant declines in economic activity. And railroad miles, which had been growing at 9% a year, right, prior to the panic, falls to 3% a year, right? And, you know, there is some discussion in the literature about, you know, how severe this particular downturn was, but certainly when we think about the impacts on the railroad industry, you know, it's quite significant. Just want to kind of take a second to appreciate just kind of the size of the corporate default crisis that we're talking about here. So this is reproduced from Gieske et al.'s 2011 paper, kind of documenting corporate default crises through over 150 years of U.S. history. Finding that by far this period following the 1873 crisis, you know, is the most significant. So the maximum default column is the fraction of the bond market measured by par value going into default in a single year. So over 16% of the market defaulting in a single year, with over a third of the market defaulting during this three-year period, right, which is significantly larger than the next largest such corporate default crisis in the 1890s and 1880s. And you can see the Great Depression clocking in down there at number four.
Chris, can I ask a quick question?
Yes.
So when did bankruptcy law get introduced?
Yeah, so there's
no... If you're going to get to that, I'll just back off.
I'll talk about kind of what the legal mechanisms are for dealing with this, but yeah, there's no law for dealing with corporate bankruptcies until I think 1898. So this is very much dealt with kind of on an ad hoc basis with when a railroad goes into default and bondholders sue and it ends up in the court, you know, the judge kind of appoints a receiver to operate the railroad and then presides over the reorganization and the, you know, dealing with who's going to end up with what, with the restructuring, right? So despite, you know, the size of this thing, so Gieske et al. Take this data and they look at macroeconomic outcomes and they find that these corporate bond default crises do not have macroeconomic effects comparable to, say, you know, banking crises, right? So, you know, where, you know, we have banking crises that might be operating through, you know, an increase in the cost of credit intermediation or the value of collateral, right? When we think about the types of companies that are issuing corporate debt, you know, typically very sizable with alternate sources of financing, typically uncollateralized debt here. So, you know, there are some reasons why the channels operating in something like a banking panic might not be there, or might not be as strong for you know, one of these corporate bond default crises. But I'm going to argue 1873 is unique. It's the first and largest of these crises. And, you know, when we think about railroads, you know, we want them to obviously continue operating as they're restructured and as this default process works itself out. So we appoint receivers to operate them, but these receivers lack some essential tools to allow them to continue operating these railroads. So the scale of this is unprecedented, and just the legal mechanisms for dealing with this are not there. Right. So first and foremost, there's this problem of debt overhang, right? So if you're a receiver that's trying to keep one of these railroads in operation after it's defaulted on its debt, you're looking for short-term financing, you know, just to keep the railroad moving. You know, a potential lender is going to look at you and say, okay, even if, you know, I think you have a profitable use for the funds that I could give you, there's all these other senior claimants on this railroad, right? So, you know, even if you can profitably use this, there's other people that have more senior claims. And so I'm not going to be willing to lend to you. The eventual solution is receiver certificates, where these receivers are able to issue debt that's senior to existing debt. But that's not in common use until it's upheld as constitutional in a Supreme Court case in the 1880s. So not available for this crisis. You also see, you know, some of these reorganizations dragging on for the better part of a decade, with holdouts and delay problems. You would see an eventual solution with equity receiverships and upset values. So being able to say to holdouts, you know, either take the proposed terms or, you know, take this outside option that we're going to set typically very low, to be able to speed up these reorganizations. But at this point, you know, those are not in place yet either. So the kind of institutional features that would allow for, you know, a continually operating transportation network, even in the face of all these defaults, are not there. And so as a result, I'm going to find that these defaults significantly interrupt the transportation network and have negative impacts in the areas in which they occur. So this is kind of a look at the default data. So you can see the full transportation network of railroads at the time, obviously with the transcontinental and you know, a rich railroad network in the Northeast and throughout the Midwest. And you can see the incidence of railroad defaults, right, concentrated in the Midwest and in the South, right? So this is going to end up being kind of a regional story of disproportionate impacts in certain areas of the country. so the data that I'm using is GIS data on the full railroad network, also incorporating rivers and canals into the transportation network. So I link this to data on which particular railroad firms are operating which lines. And I have supplemental data on the financials of the railroads, obviously railroad bond defaults, the construction versus completed status of each railroad. So I can look separately at railroads where the main trunk line is completed versus still under construction. And for the final piece, information on railroad land grants. So for the outcome variable, I'm going to be using the balance sheets of banks in national banks in areas where these railroads operated. And I'm going to argue that this is you know, kind of the best way to get at the short-term economic outcomes in these areas. So there's very few failures of national banks, only 9. So I'm going to look at changes in bank balance sheets from the observation in 1873, which is just prior to the panic in September, to over a year later. And I'll argue that the direct financial effects of the panic, specifically on the banking system, are kind of resolved by that point. So I'm trying to get at real economic outcomes through these balance sheets. So just a picture of what I'm looking at. So this is the full railroad network, the rivers and canals, and the location of all the banks that I'm using as well. So why banks? Our bank balance sheet's actually a good reflection of local economic activity. So these are all unit banks operating in one location, right? Making local loans based on their, you know, local knowledge of borrowers. We heard the very interesting talk yesterday about the advent of term loans in the Great Depression. So obviously this is the period prior to that where we have, you know, these short-term 3-month loans where we have the option of rolling them over or not, adhering to the real bills doctrine. And so there's some reasons to think that, you know, the volume of loans and the volume of banking activity should rise and fall pretty well with local economic activity. Right. And I don't want to be looking at the direct financial impact of the panic. So obviously it is a banking panic with, suspension of payments, and impacts, specifically on financial variables. So we do see an aggregate decline in loans and deposits, from the observation in September to, the aggregate numbers in December, 1873. But that's completely recovered by October, 1874, when I'm looking at individual bank balance sheets. So really what I'm looking at is geographic variation between different areas in terms of how these banks fared, right? So did banks in some areas of the country fare worse over this year-long period where these railroads are going into default and the transportation network is being disrupted? So what I'm going to use to link banks to railroads is what I call service areas. So I'm just going to allow the transportation network to kind of tell me, just set a maximum transportation cost, and tell me which railroad lines are most economically relevant to any particular location, right? A location with at least one national bank in it. So this is what that looks like for the transportation network around New York City and around Ithaca, New York. And this is also going to capture the density of rail lines in a particular area. So I'm looking at the fraction of the railroad miles within a service area that go into default. So you can imagine, if you have one railroad line around New York City going into default, just given the richness of the transportation network, right, we might not expect that to be as big a deal as if, one line around Ithaca goes into default. And so this fraction of the total miles in the service area is going to capture that, variation in the richness of the transportation network around each potential location. And so the structure of my main regression is going to be looking at, as an outcome variable, right, changes in these bank variables, loans, deposits, or excess reserves over this period, determined by the fraction of railroad miles that are going into default in this service area around the bank. And you may have already noticed, right, there's a significant endogeneity concern, right, in that both of these are being determined simultaneously, right? So if there is some unobserved geographic variation in the severity of the downturn in certain areas, right, so, a certain city or region of the country is hit harder in terms of the downturn, that's both going to make those railroads more likely to default, right? They have, larger declines in traffic and revenues and that sort of thing, and they're more likely to default. And it's also going to, banks more likely to fare worse over this period as well. So I'm going to use an IV strategy to get around that. And so I want something that's going to predict railroad defaults, but is not going to be associated with this potential unobserved heterogeneity in the severity of the downturn. So something that's measured prior to the onset of the downturn. So what I'm using there is the railroad's ratio of net earnings relative to debt, right? So kind of a measure of the financial position of the railroad prior to the panic prior to the economic downturn, right, prior to any potential heterogeneity in the impacts of the panic, right? So this is going to be a significant predictor of whether or not a railroad is likely to default, but measured prior to this potential heterogeneity that could, you know, simultaneously determine both of my variables, right? So regardless of the size of the shock in any particular area, a higher ratio of net earnings to debt is going to be associated with a lower likelihood of default. So just quickly looking at the first stage, that is indeed what we find, a significant negative relationship between earnings to debt and the percent of railroad miles in default, right? So this is the first stage regression. and the core results here. So we're looking as an explanatory variable, the fraction of railroad miles within the service area around each bank that are going into default. And relating that to the percent change in these banking variables over this period. So loans, deposits, and excess reserves. And so to interpret these results, so imagine, you know, a bank in an area where half of their local railroad miles go into default versus a bank in an area where with no local defaults. The former is going to see about a 10% decline in loans, a 20% decline in deposits, and an 80% increase in excess reserves relative to the bank in an area with no local defaults. Just very quickly, I find this is true both for railroads that are still under construction and railroads that are complete, right? You might imagine different mechanisms here, right? Just a simple collapse of construction and economic activity for railroads that are still under construction versus railroads that are complete. It's more of this, you know, receiver is unable to maintain operation of the railroad due to these financial constraints. The intuition here is that when a railroad goes into default, they have to cut back on their operations because the receiver is unable to, you know, maintain full operations of the railroads or fully meet the demand that the railroad is seeing. So I can look at the relationship between railroad operations and defaults. And so I just do a simple panel regression, just a kind of correlation between what happens in the year in which a railroad goes into default. And as the outcome variable, I'm focusing on operating expenses as kind of a summary of, both passengers and freight. And it's also, you know, more often observed for these railroads than either the passenger numbers or the freight numbers. What happens in the year in which a railroad goes into default. I also include this drought variable from the Palmer Drought Severity Index, trying to capture an exogenous source of variation in agricultural railroad demand and railroad and time fixed effects as well. What I find is defaults are associated with significant declines in operating expenses for these railroads, right? So 14% decline in operating expenses in the year in which a railroad goes into default, right? So there is at least this association between a decline in railroad operations, you know, in the year in which they experience a default. So the last piece of this is trying to get at, you know, kind of this second level question of why so many of these railroads were in such a precarious financial position in the first place. So there's a significant literature on railroad overbuilding, right? Whether these railroads were built ahead of demand. Some evidence that maybe there was not so much overbuilding in the antebellum period, but some evidence that maybe there's some stronger evidence for overbuilding among land grant railroads after the Civil War, right? So in the period that I'm looking at, you know, maybe there's something with land grant railroads where, you know, they're being built ahead of demand. And so you can imagine why this would be the case, right? The idea behind land grant policy is to incentivize these railroads to build in places that they otherwise would not, you know, by granting them land along the route that their railroad is going to go on. And so, you know, the idea of encouraging these railroads to build out in these less populated areas, right? And they also end up with land along their route as an asset, you know, and the value of that is dependent upon whether or not we expect them to complete the railroad, right? So, you know, potential reasons why these railroads might be more susceptible to a reversal of expectations here. So in terms of which railroads are the land grant railroads at this time, so I've got a map of that, we can see that they're heavily concentrated in the west, obviously the transcontinental there, and the southwest. You know, these are where these railroads are operating. Right. And these land grant railroads, they're significantly larger, they're more indebted. Right, their debt relative to capital is larger relative to other railroads. They're longer, you know, and that final line, right, that's the average population density of the counties that they're running through. So, you know, these railroads are you know, going through much less populated counties, right? So, you know, a stronger case that they're kind of being built ahead of demand and might be in a more precarious financial situation. You know, when the bond market takes a turn for the worse. And so what do I find? I find that land grant railroads are significantly more likely to default on their debt, right? So between 17 and 22% more likely. I include an indicator for whether or not, you know, this the railroad is a Western railroad, right? Is this just purely a regional story, right? Where these railroads in the West are just more likely to default? It doesn't seem to be the case, right? It seems to be, even when we include that specifically, it's these railroads that are being built using land grants. There's an interesting contrast to railroads that receive direct financial aid from states, or, you know, states that directly guarantee the bonds of these railroads, right, are being significantly less likely to default, right? So it really is this specific form of policy of using land grants to incentivize these railroads to build in these areas that kind of, you know, puts them in a more precarious financial situation. So yeah, I've got a couple minutes left. So just to kind of conclude. So the goal of this paper has been to take this, you know, significant event of this corporate default crisis that's centered around the railroad industry, right? Use the opportunity of the fact that it's centered around this particular industry, where I can actually separate geographically where these firms are operating, and look at economic outcomes in those areas to see if these, you know, defaults are actually having negative impacts in these local areas. Right. So, and, you know, I do find that banks operating in these areas, they see a significant decline in loans, 10% decline in loans, 20% decline in deposits, and an 80% increase in excess reserves for, you know, a bank that saw half of its local railroad miles go into default, which describes about, you know, a third of the sample is banks that have at least 50% of their local miles go into default. Right. Similarly, about a third of the sample has no local defaults. Right. So there is significant variation in exposure to this that's explaining a significant amount of the variation in how these banks are faring in the wake of this economic downturn. Right. And so there's some evidence that the land grant policy contributed to some of these railroads being unsound and increasing the incidence of defaults. You know, and I guess the big picture takeaway is, so yes, we might expect, we've previous papers have found that these types of corporate bond default crises, you know, might not be as severe as, you know, something like a banking crisis. But this does depend on the institutional context, right? It does depend on being able to, for a firm like a railroad, where you want it to continue operating during the restructuring process, you need to have the institutional features in place in order to, in order to successfully make that happen, right? So a poor system for maintaining service during reorganizations can actually provide a channel for these corporate default crises to have real economic impacts. So that's the end. So thank you very much. And I look forward to your comments and questions.
Thank you. Thank you very much. That was perfect timing. So now we're going to turn it to Hugh Rocca for his discussion. Again, if you have questions, please feel free to enter them in the chat, or once Hugh's done, just feel free to raise your hand and I'll try to sort through all the comments at that point. All right, so Hugh, turning it to you.
Something's happened to my screen here. Can you see anything? No.
Oh, I can see you.
You can see me, but I can't find the share screen now for some reason. Ugh. Oh, wait a minute! I'm getting better here. Okay, this should do it. Can you see it now?
Yeah.
Yes.
Oh, good. Okay.
Looks good.
Okay. This is I thought a very good paper. It's very convincing. Unfortunately, a lot of it's econometrics, and I'm not going to talk about the econometrics. I know I should be complaining about the instruments and demanding more instruments and tests of the instruments, but that's not me. I did have a course in econometrics a long time ago, actually from Tile, who was one of the inventors of two-stage least squares, and but it was a while ago. I'm just going to suggest some places in the paper where I think a case study would make the arguments a lot clearer. And in fact, Chris did do that at the beginning of his talk today, and I think just incorporating some of that material in the paper would be really useful. And I think I'm also going to talk a little bit about what he might do next. So the story is that there's a railroad goes into bankruptcy, the railroad is closed down, and local business suffers, right? And I think just a case study there, the kind of thing Chris was talking about, if you could tell us in Cincinnati or Indianapolis, the railroad was sued on a certain date, a receiver was appointed on a certain date, the receiver couldn't get the capital that he needed, so the railroad had to be closed down, the workers were sent home on a certain date, and so on. And having that in there would then, I think, introduce the econometrics. I rummaged through some sources myself. I looked on newspapers.com, and I really didn't find this story anywhere. So I think it has to be in the paper. I thought I had found something in Cyril James's book on Chicago banks, but when I read the sentence carefully, I discovered that it was a banking problem and not a railroad problem. But of course, Chicago had a large portfolio of railroads, so it didn't face the problem, maybe. Uh, And the same thing is true, I think, when he talks about in the paper about the receivers lacking tools and struggling. I think a case study where the receiver tried and failed, would kind of make the point clearer. There's also the problem of maybe it's just a bad investment. Do the receivers really always try and to keep the railroad open when it was a bad investment? And again, I think just a few stories, maybe from a memoir or a newspaper interview where a receiver told us, I wanted to keep the Cincinnati Railroad open. It's a great railroad, but I couldn't raise the capital. Nowadays, I could do it. You know, that would kind of make the point clearer, I think. Another thing I thought about while I was reading the paper was this idea of national bank loans as a proxy for local economic activity. I could see it going either way, right? So there are other institutions that are providing capital, state banks and shadow banks, that may have been hit harder, may have shown bigger losses than the national banks. Jay Cook was the Lehman Brothers of the day, and he was financing the Northern Pacific Railroad. He took private deposits and invested in the railroad, and he's gone. And you could sort of think about a bias in the opposite direction. Maybe have a one railroad town. Maybe the railroad is still operating, or some other railroad company has picked up the business. But the national bank might think, there's trouble coming. Maybe I need to strengthen our balance sheet before anything happens. So I think there could be some biases in relying completely on the national bank data. Unfortunately, the only sort of practical suggestion I have here is something a little different. I think you could do an overall counterfactual calculation. You could take all these towns, turn the ones for railroad bankruptcy into zeros, and then tell us what the effect on total bank lending was. How much worse was the contraction in bank lending because of all these bankruptcies? Right? I tried messing around a little bit with myself, trying to look at this. This is for all banks, state and national, deposits let vault cash quarterly from Friedman and Schwartz. And you can see how after the banking crisis, that's the red bar, there is a depression in bank lending, and then it catches up in 74, right? So the question, you can just kind of do a calculation, what would the contraction in bank lending have looked about like if all these ones for these cities had been turned into zeros, right? It would kind of fill it in, all of it, some of it, right, in the depression in bank lending. The thing that really interested me the most in the paper is what could, where should Chris go if he wants to stay on this track? And one thing I thought about is the Great Railroad Strike in 1877. This was one of the biggest strikes in American history. The railroad network was completely shut down, although only for a short period of time because the troops broke up the strike. But, you know, my intuition is that these railroad bankruptcies probably had a bigger impact on economic activity than this great railroad strike. But I think that would be an interesting comparison to see what impact that was. And I was also really interested in a conjecture at the end of the paper that these defaults might explain the long depression, right? So if you go to the NBR website, it tells you that the longest depression and contraction in American history was from 73 to 93, 65 months. The second place is 29 to 33, right? It's only 43 months. And I think showing that the railroad bankruptcies had a lot to do with that would be a really, really good thing. And I'll tell you why in a minute. These are controversial dates. People have criticized the timing here. The data from that period is just really not very good. This is Gallman's famous GNP figures. It really doesn't show a great contraction in this period. If you there's other data that does show some trouble, right? This is business failures, and they're going up pretty steadily from the crisis all the way until 79. Part of the story here is that it was a period of deflation. And so the farmer debtors are in trouble. This is the period of the greenbackers and the Grangers. So that may be one of the reasons why historians have seen it as a long depression. The thing that interested me most about the period, though, is this may be a real case of secular stagnation. This is the crisis year. This is industrial production, which is obviously not as broad as GNP, but maybe better, more accurate data. And you really don't see anything changing until 1879, right? And of course, if you look at, say, the Northern Pacific Railroad, that's when they start building again in 1878 and 79. And I'm sure that was true of some of the other railroad projects. So what we're really having here maybe is a real example of secular stagnation, that there was all this railroad building, the associated real estate construction, and that came to a halt with the 1873 crisis, and the economy didn't really get going again until the railroad building and other projects got going again. So I think if Chris could show us a real example of secular stagnation, I think that would be a real useful thing for the paper. So for another paper. I'm kind of running out of time here already. I just want to repeat, I think it's a great paper, and I didn't find any flaws in it, and I think it's very convincing. So that's all I have to say about it.
All right. Thank you very much, Hugh. And there's a bunch of people who put either comments or questions in the chat. And so we're going to go first to Michael Bordeaux.
Okay. I think it was a very nice paper. I had just a couple of points to make. One is on sort of why it happened, and you talked about the overexpansion thing, but it had a lot to do with corporate governance issues and the corruption that took place and the story of tunneling that many of these banks were doing. And then when these scandals broke, the British pulled out their capital. So it was kind of, there's that, corporate governance sudden stop story. And then related to that is what's going on in Europe. I mean, again, this is more of a background point, but the 1873 crisis was a global financial crisis. And Kindleberger and lots of people following him focus on what happened in Germany and Austria with a huge land boom and housing boom that turned into a bust. And the last thing is about the impact on the economy. And I think you might, I think I've talked to you this before, is to measure the spillover effects that go, you know, through the input output table, in a sense, because the spillover goes from railroads to the things that are used to produce railroads, iron and steel and lumber and leather, et cetera, et cetera. So, you know, that's one way of getting at this question. Anyway, I just throw these points out. Thank you.
All right, thanks. So Chris, if it's all right, can we just collect a few questions and so you get all the feedback, and then I'll let you make sure you have a couple minutes to respond to the things you would like to respond to. So the next person I saw, Clemens had a comment in the chat, but I wanted to give him a chance to say it out loud.
Hello, I'm not sure my mic is working. Is it
working? Yeah, okay. We can hear you.
It's basically a follow up on, I think, on what Hugh Rockoff was saying, namely whether you have some measures on to what extent operations were actually interrupted and how long it took to resume operations, and whether there are some systematic reasons why some reorganizations went faster than others. This could also serve as an input in your regressions if this is unrelated to local economic conditions. Mm-hmm.
Great, thank you. The next person I saw was Ellis, had a thought.
Thanks. So Chris, what I was wondering is if you had measures of economic activity, you know, that are associated with the regions that are differentially affected by the bankruptcies in the railroads, that you could use that perhaps as a rough gauge for what Hugh's asking you to do in a more detailed sense too, just to get a sense of what you might find.
Mm-hmm. All right, and the next question was from Francois Feld.
It's in the chat. No need to take up time repeating it.
Okay, then the next one was Chris Meisner.
Hey, Chris, that's really interesting. I struggled a little bit like through the talk, because I think of this crisis as a corporate governance problem and union, you know, Union of Northern Pacific and Jay Cook, and like barely a word is said about that.
Yeah.
You make it sound like a garden variety financial crisis. But a more direct question is, so the mechanism seems to be that the railroads go bust, it damages the local economy, and therefore the banks are hit. But a couple of things. One wonders whether, you know, there was a direct exposure, like banks were, you know, investing in this sorted railroad scheme. And most of the railways you map there appear to be the same, you know, all connected to Union Pacific and Northern Pacific. It's like the whole network. So maybe you can clarify on that. But back to the mechanism, say the railroad did damage the local economy, you know, it doesn't really make sense that just the banks near the railroads would be hurt, because, you know, I mean, the hinterland is gonna be, you know, affected too, right? I mean, they gotta live off of something. So there's gonna be a lot of spatial correlation and spillovers. So maybe you can go a little bit further and incorporate those hinterlands, and maybe you think the effect is going to be smaller there, but they're still, I mean, it's a connected world, even if you don't have a railroad. So, you know, that should just radiate through the entire economy. So that's all. Thanks.
All right. Thanks. I'm going to exercise the chair's prerogative to ask a question. And I think just to echo something that Hugh asked about, which is, you know, to what extent can you determine whether these are the banks that are genuinely pulling back on loans because there's less demand for bank credit because people are engaging in fewer transactions, and to what extent banks are restricting access to credit from their customers because they're concerned that their customers are not going to be able to take their goods to market and so are a higher credit risk. And so they're not going to extend credit. All right. And with that, I'm going to, can you just take a minute or two to respond to some of the, whatever you think you would like to respond to?
Yeah, absolutely. So yeah, thanks everyone. And yeah, there's quite a bit there. I do think this, you know, a couple people brought up this corporate governance question. I do think that's a really interesting aspect of the question. And yeah, Mike, I've seen your paper on kind of the railroad tunneling going on during this crisis. And yeah, I've thought about potential ways to kind of more systematically measure that. And, you know, it's difficult, you know, you have, you know, particular railroads that are exposed as, you know, having some form of corporate corruption or governance problems. And so, yeah, I have put some thought into kind of how to put together a more systematic data set of, you know, how you would link that to railroad outcomes. And yeah, it would definitely be difficult, but something that would be really, really interesting to see if you could kind of systematically, you know, look at which of these railroads are you know, suffering from these corruption issues and kind of link that to local economic outcomes. That would be fascinating. Just to the question of the banks holding the bonds of local railroads. So for national banks, that's, you know, my understanding is that's generally not the case, right? They're incentivized to hold these US government bonds to back up their note issue. I do have a robustness check where I, you know, there's a balance sheet entry for kind of other stocks, bonds, and financial assets. And so for national banks where that's more than 5% of their overall balance sheet, I can exclude those and find the same results. And so I do think it is, you know, you would obviously have a problem if it's just a direct financial impact on those banks because they're holding the bonds of their local railroads, but that doesn't seem to be the case. And I can exclude banks where, you know, they have a significant portion in that category and the results do seem to hold up. I also have done some spatial autocorrelation regressions as a robustness check and get similar results for that as well. I do think it would be interesting to kind of have an alternate measure of instead of this kind of service area around a bank, have some kind of point-to-point you know, measure of railroad traffic or importance of connecting particular cities. I do think the service area is kind of simpler and more straightforward. And, you know, it does capture a significant amount of the, you know, which railroads are most important to local banks and which ones are kind of further out. But yeah, I agree. There's kind of alternate trade gravity-based measures that could be that could be brought in for
one last thought.
Okay. Yeah. So for the IV, yeah, the idea was to you know that you have, you know, potential geographical variation in the downturn once it hits, and so yeah, you want something that at least, you know, plausibly is separated from that in terms of measured prior to the onset of the downturn. So just what was the financial situation of a particular railroad? What was its ability to withstand, you know, a negative economic shock and use that to predict railroad failures. So yeah, thank you very much for all your comments. I'm sorry.
All right.
All of them, but yeah, thank you.
Really good.
All right. Thank you so much.
So I think we're going to need to take at least about a 5-minute coffee break here before the next session. That was a really nice session. And we'll reconvene in about 5 minutes. Okay, so.